Appreciate the chance to speak to you today. The agenda says I'm talking about cytokine storm syndrome, and I'm going to cover that, but also some other aspects of this disease in our patients with rheumatic diseases. So one of the things that we've seen very early on with disease is this concept of cytokine storm syndrome. What I've laid out in this slide is a sort of group of syndromes that share a lot of similar features. Macrophage activation syndrome is a rare, although not terribly rare, concept that we've known for a long time in rheumatology in our patients with juvenile inflammatory arthritis, and more recently have begun to see it or recognize it in patients with Still's disease, adult onset Still's disease, even some lupus patients and other patients with connective tissue disease. Hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, or HLH, is a either familial or often induced disease by either malignancy or infection. And then we have known this cytokine release syndrome that's been seen with a CAR T cell therapy and malignancy. And they all share a number of features, but fundamentally, all of these are variations on a theme in which there is a sort of unregulated and dysregulated overactivation of the immune system. Symptomatically, all of these different syndromes share fever, cytopenias, coagulopathies, transaminitis, multi-organ system failure, including ARDS, and I think all of us recognize many of those as features of the COVID-19 infection, and some of which we'll talk about today. Over the years, we've learned that this syndrome is mediated in all these different cases by a combination of cytokine activation, including interleukin-1, interleukin-6, interleukin-18, and interferon gamma. And I've highlighted interleukin-1 and interleukin-6 because we actually have therapies directed at those specific cytokines. Next slide. On this slide, I pulled a couple of graphics from a couple of very recent papers. Obviously, with this infection, everything is very recent. The sort of cartoon on the left shows sort of the constellation of syndromes that fall under this umbrella, from the macrophage activation syndrome associated with systemic JIA on the right, to some of the other things, and including in that red circle on the bottom, the associated cytokine storm syndrome that's seen with COVID-19. The table on the right, which comes up a little small, but on the far right, you see a lot of the features of the COVID-19 syndrome that share some of the things that we see in this case with HLH. Now, HLH was recognized a number of years ago. There are some classification criteria, and there's something called an H-score, which predicts prognosis. These were developed specifically for HLH that was not associated with malignancy or infection. So you have to be a little bit cautious about using all these, but it highlights a lot of the different features that are seen across this syndrome. And what you see on the right are a number of the things, including fever, anemia, thrombocytopenia, other cytopenias that we see with COVID-19. Next slide. Management of this, particularly in the COVID-19 setting, can be complicated. The first issue is trying to recognize which patients develop this syndrome. These are the patients that get profoundly ill. These are the patients with a multi-organ system failure, the patients who wind up in the ICU and often on the ventilator support with ARDS. Diagnosis can be sort of attempted with a number of lab abnormalities, in particular elevated CRP, elevated ferritin, although the ferritin levels seen with the COVID-19 infection don't seem to be the same sort of dramatic increases seen in some of the other syndromes in this spectrum. Elevations in LDH, D-dimer, we've talked about at previous grand rounds, and cytopenias. The other issue in terms of management is trying to figure out if you want to address this particular syndrome. In other words, if you want to try to intervene to prevent some of the late stage and more serious complications of infection, when is the appropriate timing of intervention? And like so much with this disease, we're still learning on the fly. Is this appropriate to analyze and identify all hospitalized patients, just patients who are sick enough to be in the ICU, patients who require ventilatory support, or are they perhaps too late in the spectrum in this syndrome? Over the years, for all the diseases in this constellation, the mainstays of therapy have been glucocorticoids, intravenous immunoglobulin, interleukin-1 and interleukin-6 inhibition, and there are a number of therapies that do that, and particularly in the children with the JIA-associated macrophage activation syndrome, cyclosporin A. Early on, some open-label trials of tocilizumab in China suggested benefit. That's an IL-6 receptor antibody that interrupts IL-6 signaling, suggested some benefit, and in fact, tocilizumab was approved for the treatment guidelines of COVID-19 in China quite early on. A number of additional clinical trials are now ongoing. There are trials with tocilizumab, again, an IL-6 receptor antibody, sarilumab, another IL-6 receptor antibody, and I've highlighted that here because that trial is ongoing here at Northwestern. Cetuximab, which is an antibody directly against IL-6, not the receptor, and then anakinra, which is an IL-1 receptor antagonist that blocks IL-1 signaling. Anakinra was approved almost 20 years ago for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis and is used fairly commonly in systemic JIA, children with systemic features of juvenile inflammatory arthritis, and sometimes in adults with Still's disease. The sarilumab trial that's going on at Northwestern is a multi-center, multinational study. It's a phase 2-3 adaptive design. The phase 2 section is going at the sickest patients, looking at a number of different outcome measures, but primarily looking at a significant morbidity or requirement for ventilatory support, with the plan to move into a phase 3 portion of the trial once they learn something about outcome determination in the first part and expand to some of the less sick patients. It's a fairly straightforward trial. They're using three different arms, a low dose, a high dose, and a placebo arm, and they're a single IV dose of sarilumab. To give you an idea of what they're looking at here, the IV dose that's being given as a single dose here is roughly equivalent to a month's worth of dosing for our patients who have rheumatoid arthritis who are being treated with sarilumab, for which this drug is already approved. In RA, it's given sub-Q. There are a number of challenges in trying to figure out what the endpoints are going to be in managing these patients with cytokine storm syndrome, and I highlighted some. The most important one is trying to figure out what is the clinical course you're trying to intervene in. What are the outcomes that are trying to be prevented? The simplest is obviously mortality, but that's pretty blunt. Other morbidities and other comorbidities may be important, requirement for ICU care, requirement for ventilatory support, et cetera. And I highlighted CRP and fever because I think there's a cautionary note that has to be included in trials, particularly with the IL-6 inhibitor, because we've learned with IL-6 inhibitors and RA that these drugs generate profound reduction in CRP, even in the absence of significant symptomatic relief because of their effect on acute phase reactants. And we've also seen in patients with RA who've had surgery that these drugs interfere with post-op fevers. And so the concern might be that looking at simply some of those markers as a marker of response may just simply be looking at effect of the drug and not really clearance of the infection. Next slide. I'm going to shift gears and talk a little bit about our patients with rheumatic disease. From the very beginning, we have been concerned about our patients with our various diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, systemic sclerosis, et cetera. We've tried to balance the risks of therapy of the disease with the immune consequences of having active underlying disease and what that says in terms of acquiring or COVID-19 infection or having a more serious infection. Our current recommendations and what we've done from the beginning is that patients without infections, we've asked them to continue their current therapy, including any disease-modifying drugs like methotrexate or any biologic therapies. In the setting of an active infection, the current recommendations, and these come from the American College of Rheumatology, have been to continue hydroxychloroquine, but hold all the other DMARDs or biologics with the possible exception of an IL-6 inhibitor, because of what I just talked about in terms of cytokine storm syndrome. This is all speculative. This is all a group of rheumatologists recommending this. There's no good data, honestly, to support any of these. I will note that infusion therapies have been a particularly challenging issue for us. Many of our patients receive infusions of biologic therapies. These are often the older patients, often the sicker patients. And so the challenge for us has been bringing them in for infusions while worrying about exposure to the virus in the infusion center, either from other patients, from staff, and transmission in this particularly immunocompromised population. We have cut back on the number of infusion chairs we have. We have tried to spread them out. We've begun using exam rooms for infusions, but it's an ongoing issue. And now we're actually starting to face the issue of patients who have an infection but continue to need therapy, and when is it safe to bring them back into the infusion center? And it's something we're continuing to work on. Next slide. From the beginning, we've wondered whether our patients on therapy are sicker, and this is the first report that just came out a few days ago from Italy, from Milan. They looked at 123 patients with connective tissue diseases, mostly lupus, some scleroderma, some Sjogren's syndrome, some undifferentiated. Most of the patients were on disease-modifying drugs, including hydroxychloroquine. 20% were on biologics, a number were on steroids. And they found that the infection rate was not very different from what they were seeing in their region around Milan during the months of February and March when they looked at these patients. A number of them had some respiratory symptoms but weren't tested. They had a single mortality. It was a woman with systemic sclerosis who already had pulmonary disease who was on hydroxychloroquine and rituximab at the time. And their overall conclusion was that there was no sign of increased risk in these patients on these biologic and disease-modifying therapies, and they did not see a protective effect of the hydroxychloroquine. Next slide. We're continuing to accumulate other international data. On the left, there's some data from the COVID-19 Global Rheumatology Alliance. This is a large international database that we contribute to and other centers around the world contribute to as we learn of patients with rheumatologic diseases developing this infection. Main takeaway is that there's a broad spectrum of patients developing infections, including systemic lupus patients on hydroxychloroquine, which raises the question of whether hydroxychloroquine is truly protective. On the other hand, not seeing a huge increase over what we might expect in the number of infections in this population. And on the right is a European database that really came to the same conclusions. The comorbidities seen in these patients are the same comorbidities that we're used to seeing with this infection overall, hypertension, lung disease, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. Next slide. And then finally, in the last few seconds here, I want to talk a little bit about hydroxychloroquine. This has obviously been a lot in the news lately. A number of different looks at this. The early French so-called study was quite flawed. It wasn't really a study. It compared two groups at two different institutions and concluded that there was benefit in hydroxychloroquine, but a lot of issues with that particular publication. There was a small randomized trial in China that showed no benefit, but the trial was clearly underpowered to see anything. And most recently, we saw a few days ago, a retrospective analysis of patients who were hospitalized at the VA across the country. They looked at patients who were treated with hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, or no therapy at all. And overall, they actually found a higher risk of death in the hydroxychloroquine patients. These were propensity score matched to try to adjust the hazard ratios, but did not see an increased benefit from hydroxychloroquine, an increased risk, which led to some recommendation that this may not be appropriate, at least in the hospitalized population. Two other large populations that we've heard about, one in New York across a number of different centers, about 700 patients, no clear benefit from hydroxychloroquine. It was an observational study, and I've heard recently that Columbia University in Manhattan is about to put together their numbers, and they also didn't see a benefit in about 600 patients. These observational studies are not going to give us the final answer, and ultimately, we clearly need controlled data to understand whether this agent's going to help at all. And I'll wrap it up there, turn it over to the other speakers. We'll hold questions for the end, put them in.